Hi there, it's Mex. So last year, if you didn't know, my technical first episode, I call it episode zero of this PNG series, was me counting down my favorite songs of 2022. And so I'm going to do that again this year because let's be real, I had a lot of fun making that list and I've been really looking forward to making this again. So all over the internet, the music critics that I watch are saying 2023 sucked for music, that there wasn't enough music, good or bad, to comment on, and all the top songs throughout the year ranged from bigoted racist anthems to backpedals from Quality so hard they left skid marks. Yeah, I'm not bothering obtaining the song files for these because I don't like being offended, especially sonically. But can y'all hear me out here for a bit? Because 2023 kind of slapped. While not everything on this list is from 2023, I'd argue there's more 2023 on this list than there was 2022 on last year's list. And while everyone is praising country up and down, I have to think, does mainstream music even matter anymore? It felt like half the charts this year were songs from different years or sampled older, better songs. This is why I stick to my own lane with this list. Music I found this year that I liked. This is not a best of 2023 list. This is a my favorite songs of the year list. It is in no way objective. It is in no way meant to be justified as factual. It's just for fun. And I've been looking forward to making it for months, so... But yeah, 2023 was amazing for music if you were following literally anything outside the mainstream. Just so you know, I did offer up this video as a collaboration piece with some other creators and people who wanted to have commentary on a couple of my songs and also share their own thoughts on their favorite songs of the year. So you'll see them kind of spliced throughout this video. So, oh, cool. Cool. For this list, I only have two rules. The song cannot be over 20 years old to make this list. I may rank those on my personal list, which I won't show on here, but I am exempting them on here because it's going to start getting really weird if I start putting 90s songs on here. And the other rule is the same as last year. No songs from any previous year-end lists. Even lists you guys have not seen in case I ever decide to turn those into videos, and also to satisfy my OCD. With those rules, I have a small handful of disqualifications. End of the Beginning by 30 Seconds to Mars. The Kingdom is Within You by Gang of Youths. Trying to Feel Alive by Porter Robinson. The Bells of Lioness by Subsignal. Miles Ahead by The Strike. And most tragically, Say When by Fair to Midland. So this year I'm going to do something a little different. Let me stress, this list had a ton of painful cuts, and I mean painful. I have a full spreadsheet with every song that I considered for top 50, and there are well over 120 songs on that list. So I'm just going to give y'all my 100th through 51st, and we will consider this segment honorable mentions. Beatbox by NCT Dream. This is actually just outside of honorable mention territory, but I just want to point out that this song has the worst intro I've ever heard. The hell is that supposed to be? Jennifer by Sleeping Wolf. Happy Face by Jaguar Twin. Vor by Sleep Token. Lodestar by Dead Letter Circus. Uncanny Long Arms with Jane Remover by Underscores. Kapol by Angst. Terrorist by The Mayan Factor. Replace Me by Family Force 5. Still by 50 Landing. But I still felt you let go of me. God is a Freak by Peach PRC. Funny by Zed and Jasmine Thompson. Never love me, how you couldn't give me everything. Love is Embarrassing by Olivia Rodrigo. A Room on the Edge of Forever by Subsignal. Speechless by Glades. 77 Dog Years by Underscores. Rock and Roll by Eden. Jaeger Bomb by Closure in Moscow. Pop On by Rhythm Bastard. Stay by Floya. Walkin' by Denzel Curry. Person by The Aces. Morris Island by Soup Andreas. At the Road's End by Seeming. The Overpass by Gang of Youths. Sun-Bleached Flies by Ethel Kane. I'm Gonna Miss Everything by Spanish Love Songs. Monsters by Red Kitsu and When Snakes Sing. CBD by Breakins. Too extreme, now why are you dying to reach me? Radar by JID. Orange and be a sunlight and daylight savings might save a nigga life. It ain't never too bright to broad day, nigga. Nighttime vampire. Preach by Port Noir. We shut down, we don't pass out. Cut down, we still can't. Real Boy by Patricia Taxon. Nothing's Immortal by Fucked Up. The Last of Its Kind by Subsignal. Gimli by Dill. She's All I Wanna Be by Tate McRae. The fuck is this album cover? Can't Afford by Second in Command and Double T. Touching Yourself by The Japanese House. Meet Me in Montauk by Retirement Party. Cicada by Fucked Up. Tourniquet by Galt Aureus. Come On Heartache by The Menzingers. Come on, heartache, don't hurt me no more. Meet Me in the Woods by Lord Hero. Bad Nature by Nerve. Euclid by Sleep Token. Here You Are by Spanish Love Songs. Soft Hell by Closure in Moscow. Growing Sideways by Noah Kahn. Leave This Place by Leon. Finally, Run, Run, Run by McKinley Dixon. Nice on the car, hood laid out, crucified, grew much more from the love that you provide, standing on stage, hold back. Kicking things off in number 50, we've got King and Cross by Auschkia. Just vibes, man. Yeah, Bjork's cool and all, but this is my favorite Icelandic singer-songwriter. Gotta be one of his best hooks, and definitely his best overall song from what I've heard. Check this out. Number 49. You ever really like an artist, then find out later they change their sound and you can't quite connect with their music like you could with their earlier work? That's gotta be the best way to describe my relationship with Lost Boy Crow. His new stuff just does nothing for me, so I guess I gotta seek out the classics. Anything I missed? Tell me without asking. Lost Boy Crow, while a strong vocalist to begin with, is always at his best in his higher register. And while the drop was a lot for me at first, this held up surprisingly well with age. Good work. Number 48. What? I didn't write segues for all of them. Ah, this one's Mortkorg's fault. While it's no Black Hole's solid ground, it's still a strong contender for one of my favorites by the band. Some of these songs, I really don't know what to say about them, and that would definitely be the case here. I really love the echoing reverb on the hook here, and the layback instrumentation really brings to the forefront Tarek Jafar's commanding vocal delivery. Lovely song. Number 47. So, about that album exchange.
Question. Do you like songs about embracing darkness while also poking holes into Christian philosophy? Do you like campy hard rock that takes pop cues from goat-tier oldies like ABBA? Lastly, do you like Scooby-Doo? If you answer yes to all three, then I can't recommend the Ghost song Spillways enough. A song from their last album that makes way too much sense given that their persona has always been boiled down to theatrical Satanism. So put this tune on blast, take it to your local church, and get everyone to embrace their inner darkness. I'm saving music I want to talk about for my own channel, so I'll stick with one song that really stuck out to me this year. Considering that 2023 has been a very therapeutic year for me, it feels appropriate to talk about my love for Jeff Rosenstock's song Doubt, taken from his album this year, Hell Mode. Rosenstock is someone I've been a fan of since his 2016 album Worry, that put him on my radar as a cathartic voice for writing punk rock songs about the anxieties and struggles of living under capitalism. He continues that in the new album, but with a bold and therapeutic twist of maintaining and demanding hope as the pressures of capitalism feel worse than ever. The perfect example from this album is the single Doubt. It's basically about learning to overcome overwhelming feelings of doubt and the consequences of ignoring it. If you don't speak or scream, like he says in the song, you're doomed to stay living in a self-inflicted rut where your life is nothing but a monotonous cycle of feeling anxious about speaking out about the things that hurt you, remaining in a state where you do nothing to make a name for yourself. And Rosenstock goes all the way to hit home just how urgent it is to fight off these feelings, because doubt is such a dangerous yet very common sentiment in this world. This spoke to me throughout a large portion of this year. Going into 2024, it will be good to maintain the sentiment this song brings. It's a fantastic song, go check it out, and also go check out that album while you're at it.
Number 46, Ghosts of Kiev by Seher Galt. A deeply pained and impassioned piano ballad as a tribute to the fallen people of Kiev. I really appreciate the imagery of filling one's pockets with sunflower seeds so that Ukraine's national flower can take root after one's death. So much thought and respect was put into this. And given it's from one of my more recent favorite singer-songwriters, I knew this would deliver an emotional punch. And it so does. Number 45. Porter Robinson has found his way onto every single year-end list of mine since 2014 and... there's no Porter on here! The curse is lifted at long last! Now, back to the list. So now I'm singing for you till I can talk. I mean, it's technically Porter, so I guess the curse continues. This one didn't age as well for me looking back now, but it's definitely a Porter track at its heart with those vocal melodies and progressions in the hook. And of course, put together with so much emotional depth and complexity that kept me coming back for another listen. Great track. Number 44. In 2021, Spanish Love Songs held a record-tying 6 songs in my top 20, 5 of which were in the top 8. You can say, following that insanity, I had very high expectations for the newest project. I'd say, while not as approachable as Brave Face as everyone, there was still a ton to like on No Joy. And the album kicks off with... You smile for my benefit. Lifers was an immediate emotional punch straight to the gut. with references to self-doubt and self-destructive tendencies, the inability to cope with life's turmoils and pains, and a very vivid depiction of a car crash where the person depicted very clearly had a moment of weakness and crashed the car intentionally. I think the most impactful line of the song hits right after. I ask if you're okay with your head wide open. You smile for my benefit, because no, you aren't. Do not go into this album in a poor mood, because it can be extremely depressing at times, but damn does it deliver where it needs to. Number 43, Boyhood by the Japanese House. An ethereal, chilling performance by a real breakout band for me this year. We had lots of great queer music this year, for the record. This particular song feels like it splits the difference between Muna and the Soup Andreas cover of Alt-J's Tessellate. Spoiler, we'll get to Soup Andreas later. But this song is just so dreamy and feels almost like the euphoria of falling asleep next to someone you love. It's such a sweet and comforting listen. Highly recommend. Number 42. Sorry, I had to do this before you forgot a furry was making this list. So I asked Red Kitsu about this song, and this was his response. Bedtime Stories started as one idea, then became a whole other entirely. It's one of those kinds of retrospectives that you get right before you go to sleep sometimes. We all have them. Like an experience that is so soul-touching. Anxiety we replay over, or the little voice in our head that tells us we're not good enough. It's thoughts like those that we often can't get to sleep with in the first place. I'm a dreamer. When I dream big. It's a good way for me to escape into something I can fantasize in. That's what I focused on when I started writing the song. Knights, kings, and an evil queen are all out of something from a storybook. The hero and the villain each have their own story in the verses and hooks. I think it's how the listener perceives that story that makes the song resonate for them. That's the greatest feeling in the world, knowing that people can resonate with something that deep. Red Kitsu's production has always stood out to me in how clean and crisp it all is, but here he absolutely knocks it out of the park with that synth riff and the atmosphere he sets. Though I will say the lyrics feel a little underwritten and on the nose in the second verse for my taste, ultimately, the lyrics are not the focus here though. It's great work nonetheless. Check it out. Number 41. The journey to find a spiritual successor to Fair to Midland has been an endless battle, filled with overly long, mid, and otherwise forgettable acts. But I'll occasionally find a gem. Not the only song we'll get to with an overly long, needlessly pretentious, albeit very pretty outro. I mean, if you can really call it an outro, it's more like a second song tacked onto the end of it. This is just on the Spotify version though. The YouTube video only has the front half, which has a killer payoff. Interesting track. This band has my attention. Number 40. 10 years ago, my favorite song of the year was a hit song, Safe and Sound by Capital Cities. This, sadly, would be the last time a hit song would top my list. We are so far departed from 2013 and the grand scope of music that it's rare I can even rank a hit song on my list at all. With that said, here's my favorite hit song of the year. This song is cool. I like it a lot. Best production on the album. I do wish Tate McRae would stop singing with her tongue stuck to an ice cube, though. Geedy? Well, I certainly appreciate her homage to the greedy salesperson from the Rogue Camp in Diablo 2, but I'll take this over You Broke Me First. You broke me first, you squilly wabbit. Number 39. IMHO by Floor. That buzzing synth riff and Zach Grace's entrancing hook make this one instantly memorable as a great synth pop track. Floor continues to deliver even upon rediscovery of their old works. Number 38. Let's just appreciate that we have a band like Spanish Love Songs. We truly do not deserve a band like that. Hell, let's just appreciate that we have the Menzingers or the Wonder Years. I mean, you wanna know the alternative? This song frustrates me. Bruh, that chorus is straight fire. But the second half of the song I compare to Emery's cover of I Need a Hero. I'm holding up for a hero till the end of the night. was flawed if acceptable as a cover, but then it had this outro. Don't forget that we're a screamo band. Don't forget that we're a screamo band. Don't forget that we're... The first half of this song is fantastic, with an anthemic chorus and brittle and understated vocals. But then the second half, any idea of catchiness and immersion goes out the window in lieu of a melodic screaming and a conversation with a young boy played over spare instrumentation to close. You almost wrote a Welcome to the Black Parade and closed it as a generic screamo track. What a waste. Either way, yes, I can still recommend, but it could have been so much better. Number 37. While We the Kings ultimately had one good song and otherwise are the most basic-ass pop punk imaginable, so basic in fact I think there's a parody band that emulates them pretty directly, Small Pools, their direct knockoff, can actually do something they can't. Be interesting for 3 minutes. I wish you could be here. You can ride along and hope. Simulation explores exactly what the title entails. Questioning if life is a simulation, and add a damn good chorus melody reminiscent of a Neon Trees song, and you have a killer pop punk track worth salvaging. Number 36, Pendulum by Spanish Love Songs. Guys, it happened! A gay pop punk song! This is a life-changing event! Let's go! If only it weren't bitterly depressing. To be fair, that's what Spanish Love Songs does best, though. But this particular song is actually a little less depressing than the remainder of the album, more depicting the sad reality of living in the world as a queer person, with references to living your best life and being kind while a pastor calls you dangerous. It's so easy to sing along with the chorus with that empowering "you love who you love" line, but my favorite is the breakdown in the post-chorus ending on the utterance of the album's title. Stunning work by one of my new favorite bands of the 2020s. Number 35. The journey to find a spiritual successor to Fair to Midland has been an endless battle, filled with overly long, mid, and otherwise forgettable acts. But I'll occasionally find a gem. My dude just straight up wrote 3 choruses and put them all in the same song. This is what caffeinated anxiety sounds like. Enter Closure in Moscow, my absolute favorite discovery of 2023, and one that just so happened to release their first project in 9 years this past October. This is from their 2014 album, and I swear, the song seems to top itself every few moments with a new wild, batshit insane idea. It's absolutely bonkers, but totally worth a listen. Number 34. Told you it'd be on here. Well, I can't count how many times I've been outdone by nihilism. Join the mods, it's open. I cannot put a finger on what this reminds me of style-wise. Is it The Who? The Ramones? Either way, I drew a comparison on this to Biz Markie's Just a Friend, and I still stand by that statement. No, wait, it's Just a Friend if it were made by the Growlers. Number 33, Talk About Bones by Seeming. This might be the best hook Alex Reed has ever composed. Well, maybe with the exception of Go Small. This is just a damn banger of a track, hella catchy, and Alex Reed's vocal delivery is phenomenal. Check this out. Number 32, another one I can blame Mort Korgs for. Actually, this one came about in late 2022. A lot of the way I tabulate my list is based on longevity. Like, am I gonna tire of the song briefly after hearing it for the first time? In order to get play count, it's best for me to find the song earlier mid-year. It's why songs like The Bells of Lyonesse was on last year's list and not this year's, and why songs like Growing Sideways and Cruel Summer will likely show up on next year's. Either way, I used to be way into indie folk rock like Band of Horses and Midlake, but those acts were just missing something to keep me on board long term. Whatever it was, I found it here.
You know, I get this feeling from listening to this song that it's about, like, not being afraid of your own death, you know, because there's that line that there will be flames when I'm gone. It's got that weighty backdrop with the drums, and, you know, death is just standing there waiting for him, but he's accepted that, and I liked it.
Number 31, I really wanted to find more rap this year that spoke to me, but the closest I thought I was going to get was with JID and Denzel Curry early in the year. But then McKinley Dixon came out with his newest project, and yeah, most of y'all still sleeping on this guy. Feel the way you're moving now, white feet for you, step in mama's house. This emotional roller coaster of a track, we see Dixon reflect on himself, on both the sense of being a musician who's beginning to be known for his music, and how lonely it is when people only see you from the product rather than your own self. And on the broader scope, a contemplation of mortality, bringing to surface the memory of a friend who passed away far too young. Like a lot of McKinley's work, it's emotionally devastating while at the same time empowering. Please give this a chance, it's breathtaking. Number 30, Rats by Ghost. After being recommended Impera, I reached back to Ghost's previous LP titled Prequel, and, well, darkness, campiness, theatrics, all things Pascal said that can accurately describe the album to a T, with Rats as a clear standout for me. The high-pitched growl of the word rats at the back end of the chorus is such a bold choice, but absolutely wonderful. Such a timeless track all around. Happy to include it here. Number 29. So this song is here simply because this dude can belt.
Hello, Mexi boy.
What the hell are you doing here?
Wouldn't it be more like, what in the soft hell are you doing here?
I mean, you know, when I try to Google that album title, it actually autocorrects to soft shell.
Hi, can I get a cheesy gordita crunch and a soft hell taco and a pink lemonade, not too sweet, not too sour?
Anyway, here's this. I found the devil in the detail.
So, Closure in Moscow put out one hell of an album this year. Late last year, Mex introduced me to their last album, Pink Lemonade, which is where Dinosaur Boss Battle from earlier comes from. Great album overall. For favorites, I prefer Seeds of Gold for its psychedelic pop-punky perfection, or Pink Lemonade for its avant-garde Mars Volta-style prog-rocky weirdness, but Dinosaur Boss Battle is great in its own right. Their newest album, Soft Hell, came out a couple of months ago, and Mex did a live stream for its release, blew both of us away. Soft Hell the album is an unhinged schizophrenic adventure about feelings stemming from the end of a bad relationship, like losing control, faith, and sense of self, and trying to come to terms with it. Chilling at about the halfway mark is this album's third single, Keeper of the Lake, one of the more subdued and icy yet funky sounding tracks. With some glossy 80s synths, funky guitar licks, singer Krista Sink's strong vocal range, and guitarist Manny Zanelli's odd yet harmonious interjections, it builds in waves and valleys of growing despair regarding the failing relationship. As the wave of despair is about to crescendo, the singer accepts his willingness to allow the water to stop him from breathing, and portrays being dragged into the lake like his ex is kinda like an old Greg-like monster, I guess, if it was played heartbreakingly straight. The wave eventually crashes and the song overwhelms into a funky, tempestuous blur like a washing machine, and breaking into a wonderful cathartic solo to close the song out. Oh my god, the music video transcript calls Michael Barrett's solo playing as Chad Mad Lad. I wish I was complimented that hard by my own subtitles. It's super hard to pick favorites. For context, these are my songs of the year for 2023. Only songs that are released after October 2022 are eligible here. You can pause if you'd like to read my criteria. Perched high up at number 3 is a three-way tie from this album: Soft Hell the song, Keeper of the Lake, and an upcoming song. Keeper of the Lake is arguably my favorite of the three. If going by Mex's criteria, this was the song that I listened to the most off the album. If going by impact, while I don't have much relationship experience, the feeling of being overwhelmed by your own personal Keeper of the Lake is a powerful recurring monster that resonates strongly with me. I'm so fucking glad that this is here on Mex's list.
Number 28. The journey to find a spiritual successor to Fair to Midland this one actually is Fair to Midland. Yeah! When Well, my assessment from last year didn't age well.
This might be what I consider the last time I can put a Fair to Midland song on repeat like I did with this one this past spring.
I guess some things do get better with age. Anyways, this was the closer to their final album, so this really does nowadays feel like their goodbye. I love the guitar riff and the, well, I guess you'd call it the chorus. This song is 11 minutes long, but when the quiet moments give way to Dara Southern's vocals and the arrangement crashing back in never fails to get me pumped up. Fantastic work, even if this band can only be visited in hindsight. Number 27, Scene 48 by Retirement Party. This is shoegaze if it was written from a thesaurus. I mean, the lyrics are literally, I qualitatively analyze my acute sense of awareness for my environmental surroundings. Like, you were definitely that kid in English class that everyone hated because you had to show off the big words you knew. It's okay though, I was that kid too. The dweeby, loserish delivery took me a bit to come around to, but those shredding guitar riffs are too good to deny. Excellent track by an ultimately obscure band. Give this a listen, it's great. Number 26. Alright, if you're a regular of music reviewers like Todd in the Shadows, Spectrum Pulse, Rock Reviews, Diamond Axe, Needle Drop, etc., and for some reason have tuned in for this long, I'm assuming that by this point I've said or ranked something that has thrown any credibility you thought I had out the window. But that's before you see what I have at number 26.
Take a breath before my ego pop. Play a set like I'm a handmade prop.
The lyrics are hit or miss here, with him praising himself one moment and hating himself the next, but as someone who lives through mental health disorders on the regular, like, I straight up did a video talking about this really spoke to me. This one highlights more of the mellow or euphoric moments though, as opposed to number 25. Hope you didn't want to break from breakins. see what I did?
Cause behind the smile I'm so pissed. But I won't be showing emotions. No,
this, on the other hand, is the musical equivalent of a depressive meltdown. This song goes so fucking hard because sometimes you just want to clench your fist and punch down into something, but ultimately there's no solace, no relief on the other end. Now all that's happened is you've hurt your fingers and you're broken inside. That's why I absolutely relate to this. It may not be everyone's cup of tea, but I swore I'd never lie on this show. If anything, this is less embarrassing than Treat You Better by Shawn Mendes being on my 2016 list. Yep. Number 24. After 8 years, welcome back to the list, AWOL Nation. You were sorely missed. Again, I use 2013 as a reference point because AWOL Nation took up a good 3 or 4 spots on my top 20 that year. But after several years of mid or disappointing releases following his 2015 album, Aaron Bruno returned to form with this track, which, yeah, may not be quite as experimental, but splits the difference by writing a great hook, some pretty awesome multi-track vocals, and some excellent mixing in between rock and synth pop. Imagine Dragons could use some pointers in that regard for sure, because this is how you do it right. Number 23, Shooting Star by Muna. Mark Grondin's best lists from the year before usually leave me with a laundry list of albums to check out, and this is one of the highlights for me from last year. A love song written with such intricacy and longing, reminiscent of Ride the Lights by Morningwood in tone, and it's absolutely beautiful. Number 22, Real Name by Big Nothing. Just a bop of a post-punk track with some modest vocals reminiscent of Better Than Ezra and really sell the theme and mood of the song. Not groundbreaking by any stretch of the imagination, but the second verse on this I feel is extremely strong at capturing me emotionally. Great work. Looking forward to hearing more from this underrated act. Number 21. The weird thing about having a generic band name that is shared by like 10 other bands is you'll dive in to search for one band and wind up with something completely different. This was the case when I searched for a song called The World Is Outside by Ghosts and wound up with this instead.
How bright are the brightest eyes, open wide in the dead of night.
Okay, so this dude who has 56 listeners on Spotify can really freaking sing? Like, legitimately, when people try to tell me country sucks, I send them this. And while I say this is only country adjacent by way of, say, Noah Kahan or Jason Isbell, I'm not immune to a good Americana song with live instrumentation, a soft thumping rhythm you can tap your foot along with, some nice subtle touches of pedal steel, and a gorgeous lead vocal performance by frontman Reed Stripling. I know he may end up watching this list just to see what I gotta say, but let me just compliment that chorus delivery directly, because it captures such raw and pained yearning so flawlessly. An overlooked and obscure song, but absolutely not deserving to be doomed to irrelevance. I recommend the whole album, by the way. It's such a comforting listen. Number 20.
The journey to find a spiritual successor to Fair to Midland.
Enter my second favorite new discovery of 2023, Dead Letter Circus. Okay, but quick side note, why do my favorite new acts have to be three-word band titles? Last year it was Pure Reason Revolution, 2021 it was Spanish Love Songs, this year it's Dead Letter Circus and Closure in Moscow. Hell, my favorite band of all time is Fair to Midland. Yeah, Port Noir was there, and they're interesting. And then there was literally a band called Three that I did a listen of this year. They were decent, if unremarkable. This song has a haunting chorus where the instrumentation picks up and frontman Kim Benzie's vocal performance is out of this world. Check this out. Number 19. I'm finally caught up on this band's discography, and while I'd say their newest album wasn't my absolute favorite of theirs, I'm glad it even happened at all. If this is a farewell to the old and in with the new, I'd call this a nice farewell to whatever the band was before. This is far more pop-friendly than their previously chaotic and oftentimes overwhelming catalog. Some say that they shifted from a genre that they ruled to a genre they definitely aren't rulers of, but I'd say this is Mars Volta more matured. And with tracks like this, I'm ready for more. Number 18, Psychopomp by Thank You Scientist.
A friend sent me this song because he knows I like weird songs. This song is weird. It starts with a quick Indian vibe, and then it turns into ska. Then it becomes technical metal with ska trumpets. I think the trumpets are on the Egyptian scale even. It's a trip through and through. Think like Dream Theater on LSD. I really like this song, a solid 9 out of 10. As for my favorite song of the year, that's gotta go to Angus Maxx's debut album, especially the song Laser Shooting Dinosaur.
Number 17, Car Seat Headrest Gets Me Hipster Points. I found this project on Fur Affinity back in 2011 with the upload of Something Soon, and it promptly found its way to my top 5 songs of that year. Later, I had discovered that the band carved out quite a following outside of the furry fandom, his 2016 album Teens of Denial being ranked 4th on Rolling Stone's 50 Best Albums of 2016 and 29th on their 100 Best Albums of the 2010s decade. Those are no small feats. I finally gave the album a proper spin this year, and after a few listens of the band's biggest single, it finally came around on me.
Yes, Car Seat Headrests. Everyone's a little guilty pleasure band that won't necessarily get them banned from ever using the aux cord again. Drunk Driver's Killer Whales is a song partly about isolation and sadness, and as a result had a pretty profound effect on me. The quieter synth parts evoked memories of driving home from New Jersey at 3 a.m. Barely anyone else on the air state, counting the street lamps. I was not, in fact, drunk at the time. Don't drink and drive, kids. I was, however, in the lowest point of my life, dealing with, well, isolation and sadness, which makes this song feel closer to poignant nostalgia than just poignant, which perhaps is the reason it stuck with me over the last year.
Number 16. I'm going to say something very controversial yet very brave. This might be the hottest take I've ever had, and I'd be surprised if I don't get deplatformed for saying something so polarizing. Silent Running is the best song Gorillaz has ever made. Silent Running. like Feel Good Inc., Clint Eastwood, 19-2000, Dare, Left Hand Suzuki Method, Rhinestone Eyes. Yeah, they're all good, but I don't know, just this one's better. I love the repetition of Run Run Runnin' in the post-chorus, the lyrics are sharp, and Adelaide Omotayo's vocal work is excellent. I stand by my statement. It might not be the objective truth or anything, but it's the highest I've ever ranked a Gorillaz song, so take that for what it is. Number 15, The Space on the Wall by Dead Letter Circus. The melodic progressions in this chorus are fantastic. I love the way it kind of creeps up on you. I also adore the slowdown in the bridge before it crashes back in for that final variation on it. Very reminiscent of Pure Reason Revolution from last year in that regard. But such a brilliantly written song. Fantastic work. Number 14. Let it be known that in the year of our Lord 2023, my favorite ska band's music isn't even in English. They're usually ska, so I did translate the lyrics, and this is basically a German version of Slice by Five for Fighting. I'm a sucker for a good track that bathes itself in nostalgia. This is an obvious emotional bait song. It's one of those songs that you put up your lighter for in concert and sing along to. And for a band that I literally can't even understand, this is better than it has any right to be. This rocks. Number 13. Hey Laura! Take a break from kicking my ass in Spyro and talk some music with me.
Alright, what kind of music are we talking?
Well, I listened to Immersion finally.
Oh, by Pendulum?
Yeah.
And let me guess, you like The Island Part 1?
No.
Oh?
That's the second best song on Immersion. The song has such an entrancing hook, I can't help but feel, as the album states, immersed. It's such a captivating listen with a great control of its environment. But as stated a couple times on this list, it could have been higher if not for the outro.
I told you, it's so uncomfortable.
Usually when I seek out music, I don't look for the comforting ambiance of drowning.
Literally!
Laura, does this give me a pass for still liking The Island Part 1?
I think me punishing your PB in Spyro 1 is enough.
Aww. Number 12, American Teenager by Ethel Kane.
So Ethel Kane is someone I've been meaning to check out for a while now because apparently all the gays love her, and I needed to figure out why. After listening to American Teenager, I get it. We've got tragedy, we've got religious trauma, you know, all those things that, you know, LGBT people really relate to these days. Especially that line where he came home in a box, but he wanted to go, so maybe it was his fault. Like, oof. That really hit close to the heart. And I would have to say my top three tracks for 2023, Say Don't Go by Taylor Swift, Dance the Night by Dua Lipa, and then Labor by Paris Paloma.
Number 11. Oh, Menzingers, what do I do with you? I loved After the Party, but couldn't find much else that struck me in their discography. Well, at least until this year. It's so hard to be hopeful. I'm a travel wreck on the inside. It's so hard to be hopeful, but I promise you I'll... I have never heard such weary, worn-down optimism depicted quite as well as it is here. This is almost like a millennial statement. Such a phenomenal and timeless track about, yeah, the world sucks, ain't got no plans, but the sun will rise in the morning. To keep on running in the roar of the winds. Number 10. So, Soup Andreas has been releasing pop stuff off Monster Cat. Oh god, not again. I've seen this before. B-lister Mr. Suicide Cheapcore Artist goes independent to middling results that shed whatever made them good to begin with. Looking at you, Eden, and especially you, Lost Boy Crow. Yeah, his cover of Tessellate was decent, but there's no way this is gonna go well. Pardon me, I'm just gonna watch this dweeby burnout disaster go down in flames. Hate it down to the lumberyard. Build me up into something that you're proud of. I couldn't tell you how we got this far.
But hold on,
Dweeby Burnout Disaster was right, but wow, this is the best AJR song I've ever heard. Insanely catchy song with crazy relatable lyrics about growing up to be a loser with weird hobbies while your male childhood friends grow up to get into your typical masculine trappings. And I think the way Supandreas undersells his delivery, as well as his limitations as a singer, elevate this song to honest greatness. You definitely missed this one. Check this out. Number 9. Alright, full disclosure, I am 100% on board with Hannah Jocelyn.
She's outside in a cigarette. I'm outside in a respirator. She's beauty in that brother.
It's like Treat You Better by Shawn Mendes. Except it literally isn't. What kind of batshit insane take is that? Okay, well, the subject matter kinda hits on those same notes. But instead of projecting it onto this girl's lover, Hannah projects it onto herself, questioning why she can't be with her, or perhaps straight up wishing she was her. And the spare piano coupled with the hazy atmosphere of synth really works to boost the feelings of longing and desire, but the loud utterance of "show me" before crashing into the break in the middle, one of the best moments in music this year. And with Dress being in my top 6 last year, I am very eager to hear more from this artist. Incredible stuff. Number 8. Last year, Pure Reason Revolution was the band that won my cool prog rock band I've never heard of sweepstakes. This year was very tight between Closure in Moscow and this band. And while I'd say Closure in Moscow would just barely eke out on top, this track alone made it a hard decision. Like many of my favorite prog rock tracks, This Is the Warning is one large build to an incredible payoff. When the instrumentation drops and crashes back in for the album's final hook, it's like a blaze of fucking glory. This kicks ass. Anyone who loves good rock music needs to check this out. Number 7, Castaway Angels by Leprous. Starts out subtle and quiet, gradually builds and eventually catapults you into what I can only describe as one of the best vocal performances I've ever heard. From what I understand, most of this was performed in a single take. There's so much raw talent and skill at play here, from the complex drum line to the insane guitar work to the subtle touches of string. This is an absolute masterpiece of prog rock. Please check this out. Number 6. This is the best song of 2023. Yes, I mean that. This is the best song of 2023. He found it. The catchiest set of verses and pre-chorus imaginable, and if the public knew about this guy, this would be a hit. There's no denying just how earwormy this song is, and unlike annoying earworms, this is just kind of fun to have stuck in your head. Now I know what you're thinking, but Mr. Weasel Man, if this is the best song of the year, why is it in 6th? Well, I can't justify summing up the year of 2023 with a song that came out in November, first of all. Second of all, I said best, not favorite. While this song is amazing, I don't cherish it quite as much as my top 5. Give me a few months of hindsight and I'll probably regret putting it this low. So, anyways, I showed this song to Mort Korgs, and his response was, "Of course you like it, it sounds like Floor." To which I responded, "Actually, I like it because it sounds like The Strike." But actually, we're both wrong. I like it because it sounds like this. It's hard to remember how it felt before. Like, I had to question if this was directly ripped off from Gwen Stefani at first. The resemblance was so uncanny. The main difference here is that Supandreas has some really pissy lyrics in here. After all that we've been through, I hope you die. Number 5. The journey to find a spiritual successor to Fair to Midland has been an endless battle, filled with overly long, mid, and otherwise forgettable acts. But this begs a further question. Why try to replace something that was already perfect? Why not, instead, try to pave a new path forward?
Look at this man. Look at this gremlin crackhead of a man on full display like the Reno 911 guy with the short shorts, reveling in enough self-actualization that he's become Joseph's Technicolor Dreamcoat. He's become so much LSD dream emulator that he skipped straight from Bat Outta Hell, past Xavier Renegade Angel, and landed right in Bat Country. I wish I was that fucking sexy. Not only is Primal Sinister the most unhinged song from Soft Hell, Primal Sinister is one of the most unhinged pieces of music this entire year. And yes, I'm not just talking about the kooky-ass music video that they did. Of course, I say unhinged in the most delighted way possible. I fucking live for this shit.
Still better than Corey Feldman.
Like I said earlier, it's hard to pick a favorite from Soft Hell. I still believe that Keeper of the Lake resonates more with me personally, but this song is so drunk on its bitches brew that it reaches a level of gremlin bitch energy that's so powerful that Short Shorts Dreamcoat Man over here ascends to become an icon, essentially. Very few people can sell it like lead singer Chris can, but that's enough out of my muzz. Mex was so inspired that he built the fursuit dance around this, so I'll let him have the final say.
It's like a song by the Raconteurs, if it was made by the Mars Volta. Circa Amputecture. By the way, this is my highest praise. Number 4. Spanish Love Songs still rules pop punk in 2023. So I got snow and opened up my mouth. A faint surprise with no sound. The album comes full circle on this cutting and somewhat uplifting closer, if a bit cynical, but that's life, unfortunately. You're just a factor in the grand equation, but that alone is important. This song delivers one of the most innocuous lyrics that I found such profound impact from, and it's the opening lines. I watched the empire fall while I was waiting on a tire rotation. There's something so lived in and grounded in reality about a line like that. Disasters and life-changing events and traumatic experiences don't wait for the mood to be set. They happen during the fleeting and mundane moments of life. But this song comes the closest on the album to being a real pop-punk anthem, and it kicks all of the ass. This band deserves far more publicity for the work they are putting out. Number 3. Let me make it clear that while I don't repeat entries from previous years, this was my last cut from the 2022 list. Honorable mentions can make the top 50 proper the following year, as was the case here. And thank God for it, because this belongs here. You wanted to, I could show you how to move. With purpose and feel the world around. Maybe I could be the one. So about 8 or 9 years ago, EDM started creeping its way slowly into my good graces. And around 2017 and 2018, it absolutely dominated my year-end lists. But over time, you know, you go through phases, things age, and I can't really connect with EDM the same way I did. Here's the exception, because Oliver the Kid's voice is fantastic on this track. The drop, instead of being the hook, is the payoff for the constant build throughout the song, and it's almost subdued, a little bit lower on energy than you would think, but at the same time, packing such an emotional punch. This song actually took a little bit to grow on me, because this came out actually March of 2022, and while I liked it at first, it didn't really click until about the end of last year, when I absolutely got it all at once. Fantastic track. Number 2. When did it go so wrong? Remember the times when we thought algorithms were useful and had our own interests in mind? Like when we thought it was cool to try to find new songs based on the way others sounded? What was it that turned us on it? Was it when a disgruntled worker blew the whistle on Facebook? Or was it when we started associating with AI and its polarizing introduction to the world a little over a year ago? With Spotify, to me, it feels like payola is what they send to me most often. Like when I have Taylor Swift on my playlist, it feels like Spotify keeps trying to push more Taylor Swift for me to listen to so as to drive her numbers up. But occasionally Spotify gets one right. 2 years ago, Spotify sent me The Permanent Rain by The Dangerous Summer, a song that would go on to break apart the clinic that Spanish Love Songs and Porter Robinson did to my top 8 that year. For every 100 bad songs Spotify tries to reverse engineer into your good graces, there is that occasion where they get it so right. Found Sound On suggested this year, I was introduced to Floya, a German two-person electro-alternative band that put out one of the best hooks of the year with their single Willows. It took a bit for this to grow on me, but by the time it did, I was already planning a con music video for it. This song perfectly captures thrill, joy, and euphoria, all in a clean and fun package, and that multi-track belting on the hook is amazing. This absolutely rocks. You probably missed it. Give it a try. Number 1. I mentioned that this list was tight, and I had to make painful cuts. Well, that's before I tell you exactly how tight the top 15 were, because you could rewrite this script and put 15th up to 4th or 2nd down to 7th, and I could actually find a through line to believing it. With one exception. Because this was not even remotely close. From January to December, this song was on repeat. And I told y'all, I love to deep dive, to find magic in places that no one else ever will. And while scouring through the dredges that few journey into, through undiscovered talent on Spotify, most of what I get is mid or unremarkable. But I'll take 1,000 mid or unremarkable songs if it gets me even a chance to find a song like this. Curiosity peaked on the back end of Dress, I decided to see what else Hannah Jocelyn had done apart from her previous project Fell From the Tree, and found her new project The Answers In Between. Hotel Room is remarkably good, certainly too good for an artist with only a small handful of listeners. Every moment of this song is one giant build, but it's controlled, intentional, meticulously thought out, and beautiful in how clean it isn't. I love how the snares sound like hydraulics. I love how the kick drum delays in the start of each measure. While it starts out unassuming, the payoff is in the outro. At once, around the 4.5 minute mark, the song explodes into a kaleidoscope of sound. It's bright, it's colorful, the multi-track vocals add a dreamy element to it. It's absolutely remarkable how much emotional release, lyrical prowess, and atmosphere can be packaged into a single song like this. Not since Mirror by Porter Robinson in 2021 was a song able to go calendar to calendar like this, and me not tire of it one bit. And while oftentimes my top song of the year ends up getting swept away by some song with deeper meaning to myself personally or as a tie-in for a massive project of mine, this is an exception. I appreciate it simply for being what it is. Good fucking music. This artist has 10 monthly Spotify listeners, guys, so can we please get on this? It's the best song I heard in 2023. So that's my list. Have a problem with it? Tough cookies, it's my list. But want to share your own list? Please feel free in the comment section below, sharing me what your top 5 favorite songs of the year were, and I'll be happy to, hell, I might even respond to it and let you know what I think of those songs. And while you're at it, if you feel compelled and like the content I put out, please feel free to make your way over to my Patreon. I have $1, $5, $10, and $25 tiers available, but for the $1 tier, you get to see all these videos 48 hours in advance before they go on YouTube. I got additional perks available for the $5, $10, and $25 tiers available. Hell, $25 gets you basically episode requests that go to vote, and you can vote on what episode I do next. That's definitely something to consider. I understand if you guys are not able to support financially right now. I totally get it. I've been there, trust me. But even if you're not able to, please feel free to like, comment, share, and subscribe. It always helps. And anything to boost the algorithm as well, because, you know, these videos tend to get buried sometimes. Thank you guys for sticking around watching the whole thing, and I will see you guys next time. Bye-bye!